Thank you. Executive Director for Equilibrium Concert Series. Thank you all so much for coming here tonight. We are incredibly excited to have Kathleen Supové from New York. She came in yesterday, I believe, and so she's fantastic, as you will see. Couple things. The bathroom's upstairs. Some of you have already found that. It's kind of like upstairs around the corner. Yeah, you'll follow the signs. This is our seventh season. This is the last concert of our seventh season. I can't believe it's been seven seasons. But as you know, or maybe not, putting on concerts does require funds. And we are all poor musicians, of course, like some of you also. But there is information on our website if you do wish to make a contribution through Fractured Atlas. We're in the midst of planning an awesome season for next season. Some really exciting things that we'd like to really be able to do. And again, of course, that requires support. So if you feel inclined to do so, please go to the website, check out the fundraising information. Let's see. Equilibrium is myself, Stephanie Lukowski, Misa Salkind-Pearl, Matt Sherrick, who will also be performing tonight, and Jason Huffman back there in the corner. Feel free to come talk to him. Feel free to come talk to us afterwards, not during prom. So without further ado, first we have a short little EQ ensemble section, which I have a piece on. And yeah, that's about it. So welcome.
Coming everybody to our final Equilibrium concert of the season. So the theme for the EQ ensemble portion of this show is the before time. A lot of times when you're running a contemporary music series or if you're a contemporary music ensemble, you're always worried about playing composers who missed a piece, especially if your friends have said composers, it's like, I want to do this piece they just wrote. And you never really go back into the stuff they wrote a long time ago. And so this program originally had three pieces, but Ashley Fuhrer's piece had some technical difficulties we couldn't fix by this point, so sorry about that. But Aaron's piece was written right after we get finished our master's together, when he was still somewhat, like baby Aaron in terms of composing. And Curtis's piece was written when he was a senior at Oberlin, I think, so it's... I encourage all of you after the concert to chat with these two about what it's like to be a composer hearing a piece you wrote before you knew what you know now. That sentence would sound out better. Anyway, without further ado, Aaron's going to say some things about Convergence.
Right. Not too much. I know you just heard me talk. As Matt mentioned, I wrote this for a friend 2011, 2012, so at this point, you know, about 6 or 7 years ago. It was just for a performance class or something like that, but they then never actually performed it after that. So this is technically the premiere. So it's kind of interesting to hear a piece I wrote about 6 or 7 years ago premiered now. It's just kind of a short, fun little piece. It's not, you know, epic, but trying to remember what I was thinking back then. But hearing them perform it earlier during the dress rehearsal and everything, there are definitely some seeds of things that I've since then taken and kind of expanded upon or loosened up about, but I guess the title I think has to do with the two voices, you know, converging and diverging. I'm not going to go too much into it because honestly that was a while ago and I don't remember entirely. anyway, that's it.
Thank you.
2012, but I really didn't change much except to, even more recently than that, take advantage of the lower octave of the marimba. I originally wrote it for a marimba that didn't have the lower like looking at another composer's music in some ways. You know, I almost felt like I wasn't qualified to make serious composition decisions. I was tempted to write an entirely new piece when looking at the old music. So instead, it's been fun to just kind of let it be what it is and to let it come to life with this amazing group of people who have really made it vivid in a way that I don't think I could have imagined 22 years ago. A couple of little technical things about the music that even though it says unnameable narratives, you'll notice that they all have names. There are short movements named. Some of the names come from a trilogy of novels by Samuel Beckett, the novels Malloy, Malone Dies, and The Unnameable, referred to the trilogy. It's a fairly bleak but also funny in a dark way kind of worldview that comes out of the Beckett novels that I was reading at the time that I wrote these. The exact correspondences are sort of lost to my memory, but I'm sure they're in there somewhere if you've ever read the novels in question. The one thing technical that I think is worth saying about the music is that the second and the eighth movement, the second movement and the final movement, both have very loose rhythmic coordination among the instruments. In the case of the eighth movement, it's the most extreme. For each section of the piece, every one of the three players has a sort of set of materials they can choose from, different phrases that they can play in any order that they wish, which means that they're not coordinated with one another in a predictable way, although in a larger sense, the composite is sort of predictable, which means every time I hear it, it sounds different. This will be a unique performance. The same is true to a lesser degree of the second movement. I'm not sure whether knowing that affects how you hear it, but I thought it was worth knowing. I'm grateful for the opportunity to revisit this, and I think that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. observation like this.
Right.
Right. Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, thank you.
Doing that, doing all the coursework things.
like the little bit I've adapted.
Yeah.
He's still.
Oh, please.
You definitely
yeah,
know.
You definitely know. Yes, Jim is still there.
Good point.
Are you serious?
Was he doing sound? Like live sound when you were there too? Or was he just doing live sound?
Right. 5 and a half minutes.
Because I kind of always have things, so I said, okay, you know, write a chunk about what's very important for 14 years.
Yeah.
And which happens to be like the first 5 years.
And then Kathy Supové, whom you will meet in a minute, asked me in about 2014, I think, if I would write a piece for her. And I thought, that's going to be, and this is the correct title, The One Warm Spark in the Heart of the Arctic Crystal. Not at, but in. And this is the sentence that Melville uses to describe when they're out in the middle of the ocean. And it's they're in the doldrums, actually, and the boat is just sitting there, but it's the way the water is described and the sunlight on the water is, you feel like you're there. And so this piece of mine is supposed to be like being in the middle of the ocean, completely quiet except for the sound of the water and the sounds of the birds, the sounds of the environment, and the sparkle of the sun on the water and all of those things. And then there is one surprise in my piece, which is the warm spark, but you'll hear it, you'll know what it is. So I am very, very excited and honored to be the person who gets to introduce Kathy to all of you. Kathy Kathy and her husband Randy Woolf have been very close, very dear friends of mine since the mid 80s. And you can read about Kathy in the program, but the thing I would like to say is that single-handedly she's increased the repertoire of modern piano music exponentially. She's responsible for so much music. She is one of the incredible good citizens of modern music, asking pretty much every composer she knows to write a piece for her. This piece of mine that you'll hear is the fourth piece that I've written for her. And I'm very, very excited that you get to hear it, and I'm very excited and honored to introduce her, and Kathy Supové.
Thank you. much, Marty, for writing such a wonderful piece. And I'm delighted to be here tonight to play this and to play the rest of the program. You know, I'm one of these people, I love apologizing for things all the time. You know, like I'll apologize to a chair for, you know, and so this is really fun tonight because I get to, like, make some excuses and apologies and all sorts of things. So here I go. I have two major ones. The first one is that my husband stole my laptop over the weekend. I was without a laptop, and thanks to the wonderful Matt Sherrick, who you heard play percussion in the first half, agreed to step in as sound person. And so thank you very much. I'd like to give it up for him. So if anything seems weird about the movement, if my right arm suddenly, like, flies away, that's what will happen. But actually, I'm considering myself just lucky to be here and be playing. The next piece, I'm wearing my heart on my sleeve a little bit. And the composer of the next piece is also a composer who, I think a lot of her music wears her heart on her sleeve, and to wonderful effect, I think. And her name is Alexandra Bois, and she's a New York composer, also does a lot out in L.A., Los Angeles. And the piece Fjord was a tribute to that part of the world where there are fjords, and that kind of landscape had given her great solace around the time she was writing this piece, and actually in the months leading up to it. It was right around, I think she had some personal trauma, a big breakup in her life, but also there was the matter of the election. And she's, like many of us, you know, suffering emotional reactions to it, let's just say that. And, you know, I should keep politics out of this, right? And she wrote a very emotional piece about beautiful landscape. Hope you enjoy it. Marty is very good at all sorts of cooking and many other domestic ones, getting screws out of pans. Brooklyn-based composer who happens to live with me, is my husband. And actually, we met in Boston. We met in the outer hallway of New England Conservatory. Like when you go in the NEC and turn right and start around the corner, that's right there where we met. So Randy, you know, knows things about me. That's part of the deal, you know. One of the things he knew is that I had never heard the Abbott and Costello routine, Who's On First? Is there anyone here who has never heard Who's On First? Oh my gosh, I was more culturally deprived than I even imagined. I've never heard it. So he said, well, you can't go through life and have not heard Who's On First. So he found an audio recording of it, you know, gave me some playback and put it in an iPod or something and locked me in our bedroom and recorded my reactions to it. I laughed a lot. And actually, I've listened to it subsequently, and it's even funnier a few years later, I think. But anyway, I listened to it, and he recorded my laughter and cut it up. And he didn't really process it. He just mostly cut it up in different ways, but he pitch shifted it and did some things to it. And that's the result of this piece. This piece is in 9 short movements, by the way. And they are, even though the Unnamable piece had the titles, the movements had names, these don't. And oh, there's some, what is it, 5 and 6 are merged as one. And something like that, but you'll get the idea. Okay. And Randy writes with a lot of humor and often, very often with a lot of humor. And that's nice because there could always be more humor in the music right now. Thank you.
Thank you.
that when we met in the car last year, last spring in Bowling Green, Ohio, you gave me, very nicely gave me a ride back to the dorm from the bar. And you know, you came to this, right? Thank you so much for having me, and thank you all for coming. There will be no concert. thank you. The last piece is by New York composer Annie Gosfield. I don't know if any of you know her music. She's also a very, very accomplished rock pianist and keyboard player, I should say, synth player. And I think a lot of this piece reflects that. You'll hear sounds that sound like vintage keyboards. They're sampled sounds that sound like them. And she's very aware of that. The piece, the piece was inspired by Hurricane Sandy, actually, which hit New York very hard. And actually some parts of my neighborhood, actually very near me. And so you could hear sampled sounds from the wind that was in that hurricane also, that she recorded. This is based, it's part of a project I did called, I called it Digital WC while I was working on it. And it was, I had challenged some composers to write a piece influenced by WC, but that brought WC into the 21st century. So she based her piece on the WC prelude, What the West Wind Has Seen. If any of you know that or played that or anything, it's one of the very difficult virtuosic preludes of WC. And you can hear it and hear it's quoted. And it's part of a CD. I finally put out a CD of these pieces, and it's called The WC Effect, and you can buy it or download it. I have a few copies here, even if you'd like to buy it tonight. I give you a special rate tonight. I'm serious. I'm trying to think of it, if there's some trivia in here. See, I already gave away the name of the piece. I was thinking if somebody could identify it, I would give you a free CD. Now I clued you all in on it. Anyway, ask me about it later if you want to know. And again, thank you so much.